Hello, people of the internet, and welcome to episode 6 of the Unnamed Games Podcast. I am Craig Larter, aka Indiana Bond, and I'm back after a week off last week when I left you in the capable hands of Mr. Ratley, and we had our guest, Julian, the crazy one. Certainly polarised opinions, I think, that boy, but it was all good nonetheless. So before I go into introduce who we've got today, I just wanted to say to everybody, wherever you're listening to the podcast, whatever favourite service you're on, whether that's on Stitcher or on Apple Podcasts, please subscribe and leave a review. You know, if you like what we're doing, it's really nice to kind of get that feedback if we can. And also follow us on Twitter at Unnamed Games Pod. And you can send us some information and some questions. Maybe we can read some stuff out on the podcast and just try and grow it a little bit, really. But we appreciate everyone who is listening so far. So going over to introductions. First, I have Phil Thompson, Speed Freak. Phil, how are you, my man?
I am spectacular, thank you very much.
Spectacular.
Looking forward to a lovely evening of podcasting.
Superb. I also have Alan Howlett, Longfangs. How are you, mate?
I'll tell you what, Craig, I'm so happy you're back.
Aw, thanks, mate. I really appreciate it. Oh, thanks.
Well, that's a bit hurtful. I didn't think Chris did that bad a job.
Chris did a fantastic job. Speaking of Chris, Chris Ratley Ratster, how are you, buddy?
I'm not talking to Alan anymore.
Oh,
I did not say you didn't. For goodness sake.
Sorry, Alan, I think Chris is just reading between the lines here. Yeah, you know what you really mean.
I know how it is. I can see what's going on. No, I'm good, man. I'm good. Yeah. I'm glad to be back for another week of podcasting with my friends and fellow co-hosts. It'll be a good laugh, I think. And I'm glad you're back, Craig, because it means I don't have to do all that stuff.
That is it, you know. It can be a little stressful sometimes when you're trying to do this hosting malarkey, you know, trying to keep everyone in line. Now you know how I feel.
Yeah, I mean, he did draw the short straw. I mean, you know, Jules does require more handling than most.
I think Jules requires a cattle prod, to be perfectly honest.
I was going to say, some kind of high voltage implement.
Yeah.
Along the taser lines is always a good choice.
Can't help feeling we should have gone down to the pub and bought him back a lot sooner.
Yeah, I think you're probably right, actually. Right, so for this week, we're going to go through some news. We've got a couple of bits to go on, just some bits about PlayStation, some bits about cinema, and some bits about the Xbox. Then we're going to have a talking point, and I have got a game very much inspired by, firstly, another podcast I listen to, and secondly, the blood feud that is Alan and Chris over these bloody questions, whether they're about Ark or Gears of War, but we're gonna settle it all, and it's going to be nice, okay? So we're going to be back right after this. Hello, everybody, and welcome back from that very, very short break. Right, so we're moving on to the news now. Now, we've had a real run of it with news recently, and pretty much from the start of the podcast, where it's been absolutely ram-packed with massive, massive news. That is not the case this week. It's a lot lighter, which actually is pretty cool, because it gives us a chance to kind of go into a few little points and then maybe go a bit more into a talking point later. So the first thing I wanted to chat about this week was the Xbox Series X. It's been a kind of a trickle of news continually over the past few weeks as Microsoft have got the console out into people's hands. People have been using it, kind of influencers and reviewers. Recently they've had Dirt 5 coverage come out, which is actually the first Xbox One X/S optimized game for people to have a hands-on impression. And I thought it was a good thing to have a bit of a chat about and just see what people's impressions so far of it, really. So what I'm going to do first off is I'm going to pop over to Chris first and see what his thoughts are on Dirt. I know he's not a massive racing game fan, but, you know, it's still exciting stuff, isn't it?
I mean, it's like you say, it's not really my thing. Like the only races I've ever, I think, I mean, obviously Horizon is a weird one because it's not a purebred racer. It's just like a proper fun game. And the only other game I can recall really getting into games-wise, racing-wise, in a big way, was Project Gotham way back in the original OG Xbox days. And Microsoft, bring back Project Gotham Racing. It's so good. Anyway,
yes,
moving
please.
On. my slight plea aside, the coverage is great. I mean, you know, we got like some confirmed 120 FPS, I believe, on that one. You know, there was some really good talk from Digital Foundry as well, like going back a little bit further with the developer talking about, you know, developing for the new consoles, and he had a lot to say about Series S as well, and like all this talk about it will hold back the generation, etc. And the guy was like, look, it doesn't at all. We just make the same game and then just downscale the graphics. It's like simple as that. And seeing the game run, like, you know, and well, obviously I can't see 120 FPS. I don't have a 120 FPS display. I don't, that's YouTube as well is going to be the problem there. But hearing the positivity and like the people say, yeah, this just, it does make a huge difference. The game looks great. The game plays great. You know, it's hard for me to get excited about a game I'm never going to be excited about, which is the tricky thing. I think that overall it's positive coverage and I like that. I like that, you know, it doesn't matter whether we're hearing about PlayStation or Xbox at the minute, everything seems to be pretty much universally positive, you know, so the nice thing there is if you're into racing games, you know, you've got a great thing coming up with Dirt 5 and there'll be Forza as well on the Xbox. And I'm sure there'll be, I mean, I haven't seen the lineup for, I think there's a racing game in the lineup for PS5. But we know there's going to be a good PS5 racer in there. Oh, Dirt is as well. Dirt's there. Sorry, I forgot about that. It's cross-platform. But, you know, yeah. I think it's great news for those games who like it. I think it sets the tone for the console really nicely as well. Like, you know, we know that a lot of this stuff they were talking about isn't just them flapping their gums and going, look, we can do 120 FPS. And then we never see a 120 FPS title till like 6 years into the console. It's happening there in front of you, you know? So I'm excited, but like more about the reality it brings, not the game itself.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. I mean, I think it's, you know, a bit of almost like a technical showcase, isn't it? Yeah. Or something like that to say, look, we can do it. You're totally right with that. We've got to remember, you know, this is going to be the first run of games onto a new generation. Mm. And if you look at, I don't know, let's take the Xbox 360, for example, when you look at GTA 5 and then you look at Perfect Dark Zero at two ends of the generation, they're night and day, you know, yeah. So it's just kind of a teaser of what's potentially coming in the future, really. Now, I know someone else on this podcast is a bit more, well, both the other boys are a bit more racing fans, really. But I'm going to go over to Phil next. I know you like a racer, Phil. Are you excited for Dirt 5? Any thoughts on what they were kind of teasing with it?
I am really quite excited for Dirt 5. I'm not the biggest rally fan, just because it's difficult.
Yeah.
Like, it's so much harder racing on dirt, particularly with a racing wheel, than it is racing on a track. Because there's just a lot of variation in the surface and, you know, you've got to interpret all the feedback and stuff. But I am looking forward to what Dirt 5 brings. Particularly the 120 frames, I think, would be really interesting to see because I do have a TV that is capable of it. So I'm quite excited to see the difference I'm going to get at 120 frames versus 60. And just from a technical standpoint, actually, if I remember correctly, Ori is getting an upgrade as well. And they're going to be able to do 4K 120 on that, I believe.
Yeah, I think so.
Very
think you're
interesting
right.
to see as well.
Ori, do you mean? Ori in
Ori.
The, yeah. Ori, so, yeah, that, Ori, yeah. I don't know if that 120 is coming at... It said fully optimized for Series X on the list today, so I don't know if that includes the 120 FPS. I really hope it does, because that will look mega.
Yeah, I think that was the Series X optimization, was the 120 frames, because nice. They could already run 4K, couldn't they? And it already had amazing HDR, yeah. And particularly, and
Sorry, man, I keep over-talking.
No, carry on.
I was just saying, it's such a beautiful game. Like, genuinely, the first one was stunning. The second one is equally pretty. Like, that is going to look mega running in super smooth frame rates, in my opinion.
Yeah. Particularly, I mean, circling back to Dirt, as that was the subject of the conversation, I did used to really like some of the older Dirt games, particularly, like, the Dirt Showdown ones they had, where they had, like, sponsorship from Ken Block, and there was a lot more of, like, his kind of Gymkhana stuff in there as well. So I'm excited to see if they bring some of that stuff back with it as well. And, you know, I love a racing game. I mean, I'll be honest, I'm much more excited to see the upgrade for Horizon 4 and what Forza 8 brings a bit further down the line, because that's more my kind of jam. But I'm still going to get Dirt 5. I'm still going to play it. I'm sure I'm going to love it. I can't wait to test out that 120 FPS with my racing wheel. It's going to be awesome, man.
Nice, man. Yeah, I mean, you're in that fortunate position where you have got a 120 hertz panel with that OLED, that LG C8 OLED, haven't you? So, or is it C9 you've got?
It was the C9, which got the upgrade for the 120.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, very pretty nice. TV. So that's going to bring us over to, last but not least, Alan. And I wish I could kind of say to Alan, tell me about how you're so excited with this Series X upgrade for Cyberpunk 2077, because I know that's what he'd really like to talk about. But unfortunately, that's not there at launch. So what do you think of the stuff at the moment that's going to have some kind of X stroke S upgrade, maybe even Dirt 5?
I mean, what I found interesting after I watched the, was it Digital Foundry playing Dirt 5? And what I found interesting about that was not so much the graphics. I expect excellent graphics. At this stage of the game, we're getting excellent graphics on racing games on this generation. So For me, what I found interesting was a couple of things. I thought that it was very interesting that they were offering different graphical options. So you've got your image quality or your frame rate or the 120 FPS. So that's quite nice. You can kind of configure it the way that you want it. And for a racer, I can see a lot of people wanting to get to that 120 FPS because you've got that more immediate instant response. And in a racer, that's really needed, that along with first person shooters. So I thought that was quite an interesting point. They also talked about the other effects, so the fog and, you know, the how the ground is dispersed by the vehicles and everything else. And, you know, I mean, it looks amazing. And I can't, as Chris said, you know, I can't see it in the 120 FPS, but I can see the vehicles driving across these muddy tracks. And from what I understood from the video, it looks to me like those marks stay there. So you're going around a dirt track and you come back round and all the marks from your previous lap are still there. It really, really impressive how it deforms the ground. They were saying there's so much going on. The only time they actually saw a frame dip was actually at the starting line at the pit when they before they set out, and that was very minimal. But all the way through, everything is absolutely at 120 FPS. And the other thing was, they were talking about the sandbox mode that you get with Dirt 5, where you can create your own tracks. Yeah, and yeah. You know me, I love creating stuff, especially in computer games and things like that, you know, Ark. But, you know, I used to be very much into the Far Cry editor. You remember that came out? I think it was only the second one, where you could go in and you could build your own maps and stuff like
yes.
that.
Yes.
So yeah. I'm very, very interested in that sort of stuff, even in a racer, to be honest. But one of the things I used to remember was you'd run out of memory for the amount of objects that you could put into your, you know, your creation, because there simply wasn't enough memory there to kind of cope with that many items. And what they were effectively saying was they filled up the entire arena that's available, and it's not a small arena. They put tons of stuff in there, and they were nowhere near the maximum amount that you could have with the memory available. And that kind of shows the power and the capacity of the next generation. So, you know, I thought that was really, really interesting. And it looks glorious. And if Phil's getting it, that means I'm getting it too. Unless you buy it on the PC, Phil. Don't do it.
Got to love a bit of game share, haven't you? Got to love a bit of game share.
So, yeah. You know, I'm the same as Phil. I do love rally games, but they're so ridiculously hard. Let's not even talk about the snow levels. But I certainly will be wanting to put that on just to see how absolutely glorious it looks on the X.
Yeah, I'm not a massive rally game fan. I quite enjoy a rally game. I'm not massively excited for Dirt, but I am excited to see it as a technical showcase.
Totally.
Okay, yeah, so moving on to the next point we've got here. You know, we're doing a recording here, which is all fine. You know, I've asked you guys, is it okay if I record you? And you've said, yeah, that's fine. You know, we're chatting about stuff. The new PlayStation update would like to ask its customers if it can record what they're saying through their chat. Now, the purpose of this is that they can review conversations. So I appreciate, you know, online can be a pretty toxic place, whether that be on Xboxes, PlayStations, PC, whatever. You know, there can be some horrible, horrible things said because anonymity can bring the worst out in people sometimes. So I can see why they're wanting to, you know, use this to review back conversations if things have been reported for nasty things being said. But I kind of guess I wanted to ask you guys what you thought of this, really. You know, is it an invasion of privacy? You know, have they gone too far with this? Or is it a justified way of moderating the player base? And I think, you know, first off, I wanted to go and just talk to Phil about this and see if he had any thoughts on it.
Yeah, so I was reading through an article, particularly, you know, I looked through that and, I mean, I ended up reading one, I think, that was on The Verve that sort of went down the deep, dark route of, like, you know, perhaps an unwelcome feature arrived. Because I believe it's the operating system itself, so it's not just PS5 that's going to do it. It's backward compatible in terms of PS4 as well. It was, I think, their 8.0 update. They've added it where essentially it cloud records your conversations, and then if somebody flags it up, they go back and review it. What do I think? I think that's a bit of a... I don't know whether I think it's a good thing or a bad thing, to be honest with you. Like, I mean, you've got all these devices like Alexa and Siri and, you know, Google Assistant, and they're all listening to you and recording your conversations. Not per se recording your conversations, but recording how you speak so it can better understand the way you pronounce words and your voice and linguistics like that. And that's, you know, that's happening anyway. We're all agreeing to this sort of thing. So Sony kind of adding it in, it's all kind of similar and down the same vein in terms of they're just listening and they'll use it to improve voice recognition and things. The fact that they're then going to start reviewing it and then slapping bans against people, I think maybe crosses the line a little bit.
It's a tough one, isn't it? Because, I mean, I think we've all said things in stress and anger online at people that we probably regret saying at times, and to have that held against you, you know, because sometimes emotion takes hold, doesn't it? And actually, do you want to be recorded all the time? I don't know how comfortable I'd be with that. Not that I say particularly bad things all the time, and maybe it was more when I was younger, but, you know, people could end up getting bans for, you know, silly little things, really. I don't know. But what's your thoughts on it, Alan?
It's a difficult one because I definitely hear what you're saying, Craig, you know, but at the same time, I mean, maybe I'm in a minority here, but I kind of think that if you think that we aren't being tracked, or if you think that our emails aren't being looked at or stuff like that, then in this modern technological age, I think that's a little naive. We all walk around with a mobile phone, pretty much 90% of the population, I believe the number is something like that. And if you don't think people can track you on that, then you know, you're living in cloud cuckoo land. As far as you know, them recording your voice, you know, there is definitely an argument for that. I mean, I for many years now, I haven't played on online shooters and listened to the in-game chat. It's, as you say, very, very toxic. You have 13-year-olds making aspersions against your mother, you know, and it's like, but I don't get upset by that anymore. I just take myself out of the equation. I've got no reason. I do think there should be some comeuppance for that kind of behaviour, though. The excuse that, you know, oh, I'd said something wrong. Yes, if you have one mark against you, that's fine. You know, you make a mistake. Everybody's human. But if there are repeated offences and those are flagged up, then, you know, they'll have the, you know, the information that they need to say, well, I'm sorry, but, you know, you're abusing our service and we're going to ban you. So I'm kind of in the position where I don't really care if they were recording my voice. I've got an Alexa in my house, fairly sure that Jeff's listening in occasionally. but no, he's not. He's really not. And my views are mine alone. They're not Amazon's, just for the record. But you know, I don't really worry about that side of things. So from my point of view, I don't really mind. But I do think there is something, you know, they're trying to address a real problem. And in that sense, I will give them a little bit of kudos in that respect.
Yeah, you know, it is a tough one. It, you know, it's really polarizing, I think. I know that Xbox, you know, they do a similar kind of thing, but with text-based stuff. Because my boys, they've been in situations. I've had a parent knock on my door with their son saying, right, in you go, apologize, because he's just got himself a ban for a week for telling one of my boys to F off. And they've had one of my boys get a ban for 2 days for telling their mate to F off or whatever on a message. You know, when they're just getting a bit stressed out and they've stolen their gun on Fortnite or whatever, you know. So it does happen at the minute. But, you know, what are your thoughts, Chris? Is the audio thing just taking it that next level? Is it going too far, or is it okay still?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the guys have said a lot of stuff like, we've got tons of devices that can record us and are listening all the time. You know, your phone's doing it, you've got Alexa's, you've got, you know, Google Homes, all this sort of stuff. And, you know, they all do it, and it's thing. This is going to sound really bad. One concern with Sony doing it is, like, they've not had the best track record with cybersecurity, let's be honest. And I'm not going to sling mud, but that's just, it's out there, it's fact, you know. It's kind of like, but also having read through it, like, the big thing is it's not recording your audio unless you're in a party. Now, I play, as you guys know, a lot of The Division, right? And the Dark Zone in the first Division, I spent hundreds, if not thousands of hours in the Dark Zone, The Division. And I can tell you now that some of the people I was in a party with said some pretty toxic things, right? It's just the way, is that Dark Zone encouraged that. But I can tell you now that they weren't toxic when I was in a party with them. They were toxic when we were in proxy chat. And proxy chat is where toxicity comes out, right? You won't see it in a party because you're only really ever in a party with your friends. It's extremely rare that you'll be in a party with somebody who's not your mate. And if you're in a party with your mate, you kind of know where the boundaries are generally. I mean, don't get me wrong, I know that there are exceptions to this, but you could bet that most of the time you're in a party with somebody, they're someone you know, right? When you're in a proxy chat situation, like The Division's Dark Zone or PUBG, something like that, which wasn't on consoles, but it was on the proxy chat wasn't on console, sorry, it was on the PC. Like, the Dark Zone, The Division, like, how the people I dealt with in there hadn't been banned a million times over for some of the things they said. It was genuinely, it made me lose a little bit of faith in humanity at points. The stuff people would say, I'm like, wow, you people are beyond disgusting, you know. Yeah. And you could report them, but it was like, was there any proof of it? No. So it's tough, you know, like to have that that whole thing of, what's the word for it, you know, fairness in it. Because I also send this the swing side of that, where I've got friends who I've been playing with, and like, for example, they've had reports made against them for non-offensive things. I said, I've had it against me. I've been reported for offensive content. And don't get me wrong, I've said some, like you say, in the heat of battle, I've used some harsh language, etc. But I've been reported when I didn't do anything wrong. And you're like, well, this system is open to abuse. So in some ways, it's great, because they're going to be, I say, well, have you got an audio clip of it? And it'll be like, well, no. Well, if you haven't got an audio clip of it, you know, can we really prove it? But like, some of the stuff I've heard people say online is genuinely like heartbreaking. Like, you're like, oh my God, are we really still in this place? You know? So I get it, but I do think recording party chats when you spend most of your time in a party with your friends, it's not going to solve this problem. You know,
yeah.
we need to look at, you know, like recording, like, so when I do a recording on Xbox Live, for example, I don't know if this works the same with PlayStation. I think it does. Say you're in a game clip. So if I was in the Division and someone was going off on one, and I do it on my Xbox, it won't include the audio from those other players for privacy reasons, right? It will include certain things. And it's like, well, okay, so if it doesn't include that audio and it just includes that, I've got no proof. I know I could have a game capture card to a PC and that'd be great. But we're in that same situation. Like, so, you know, I'm not sure if the party chat thing is as big a deal as it seems. I'm not keen on, like, any company doing it, but Sony's track record is a little bit of a concern for me. But we'll see. Sony are obviously making you know, headway in a lot of things, so fingers crossed. This thing, we'll see what comes of this, see if it gets abused, things like that.
Yeah, I think a
is
big
it a
point
slippery
that
slope?
Totally, Alan, yeah. I think a good point that you've made there, though, is the whole party chat thing. Generally, it's going to be with your friends. And actually, that's almost sort of moved my mindset a little bit to, again, you know, because I've got kids, you know, and I do think about things like cyberbullying and things like that, because, you know, he plays with friends from school on Xbox Live. They have WhatsApp, but that's as far as I'll let him go with it. You know, there's some kids on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter and all that as well. But you know, sometimes he's, you know, had a falling out on a game he's playing with his mates, and he's been in tears, you know, because he's been almost bullied a little bit and sort of told to get out of the party, you know, and stuff like that. So, you know, it's I can kind of see the benefit to it that way. And you're effectively, if you're having a chat with your mates, you're saying this is kind of cool for us to talk that way. It's
It depends. I mean, with kids, it's very different. Like, you know, kids is a very different story. And you know, it's really tricky, because, you know, kids in a modern age, these things are part of their life, and kids are going to say, kids will test boundaries, is what they do, right? They'll say things and see what they can get away with. You know, it's how they learn where the line stops, essentially, right? But it's like, it's a life lesson in itself, and as much as that's horrible to say, you know, someone is going to be mean to you if you don't like it. This is the same thing comes back to social media, right? Just don't like it, they mean to you, block them. Move on.
Yeah,
it's a great lesson in itself. But, you know, it's harsh to say, but I do agree with Alan said, slippery slope. There is that danger that, you know, where is it going to go, I guess. But we could go onto this for hours, I think, you know, that whole
Yeah, it's kind of made me reconsider as well, to be honest, kind of a sort of a more of a halfway point, because if you're talking about party chat, then, you know, I'm thinking about some of the conversations we've had in games. And you know, it's all good fun, you know, we're all friends, but some of our language is, let's just say, colourful. And some of it, if it was colourful. And some of it, if it was heard outside of context of our group, would be considered, and let's be honest here, offensive. And I'm sure we're not alone in that, but we're in the comfort of a small group of friends, and we know that we're joking about stuff. However, if that chat was taken out of context, it could be seen in a very different light, and that would concern me. That's you know, secret police. That's basically checking freedom of speech. And if we're in a party and everybody's involved, then there's no issue.
Well, also that thing of like offences, you know, it's up to someone to take offence. Like I have a fairly profane mouth. I do like to shoot off four-letter words quite regularly. I'm quite reserved on this podcast. I'm very reserved, in fact. I think Craig commented the other night when we were playing Sea of Thieves. He was like, oh my God, I've forgotten how. And I was like, yep, that's me. so like someone could come jump in a party with me who doesn't know me. And that's just me being me. And I'm not doing it to offend anyone. It's just who I am. And they could go, I'm reporting you. I'm getting you banned. And I'd be like, what did I do? I wasn't, and that's the thing, isn't it? Like, you know, I would never, ever, like, as a person, as a human being, I never want to hurt or offend anyone. And like, recently I had an incident where someone said, oh, that in of itself is offensive. And we had a bit of a long discussion about it, me and this person. And, you know, it was never something I meant to hurt anyone. I was like, look, I'm really sorry if I upset you, you know, it's not my intention. I explained where I was coming from. And yeah, we eventually sort of, you know, found our middle ground and our happiness, and they understood what I was, you know, about. And they said it was, you know, it wasn't anything like horrifically offensive, but it was a learning lesson for me, you know. And like, I realized that maybe sometimes I've got to remember that every single person is different and every single person is still different. But like you say, it's like, if someone jumps in and suddenly goes, well, I find you offensive because you used a word that I don't like, you know, that's dangerous ground. And it could be open to abuse. And it's a tough, really, really difficult situation. I just have my concerns definitely. About what's going on. It's just a tough one.
Yeah, yeah. Dave, something you want to add there, Phil?
Yeah, I was just thinking about that because I'd almost forgotten it was actually just the party audio that they're recording. And I think the point that Chris made about, you know, you're mainly in parties with your mates, you're not in there with random people. They're recording the wrong audio. They should be recording the public audio. Like,
that's what I'm saying, proxy
chat.
You know,
if you're... Yeah, exactly. Your proximity chat or your game chat. You know, if you join a lobby on Call of Duty with 12 other people and you're effing and blinding and throwing racist slurs and whatever like that, that's when you shouldn't be doing it because you're with complete strangers you don't know. They don't know the context. Exactly. That's when they should be banning people and that's when they should be moderating it. So I think they need to flip this on its head, actually. Like the party chat, that's fair game. You're in with your mates. You should kind of know what you're in for, realistically. Particularly we do. But when you're on a public forum, you know, you're playing Fortnite, you're playing Call of Duty, that's the audio that should be recorded. That's the audio that should be reviewed.
Mm. Yeah.
Actually, then you've got the full context of it as well.
Totally agree.
I had a really, just touching on it again, just before we drop it, I don't want to go on too long, but it's a really good point you make. So talking about like playing The Division, I made some friends with some people and, you know, they're from America and they talk a certain way because they're American. They're black Americans and they talk in a certain way using certain language that I can't touch and would never want to. It's not anything that I want to go near. And I literally had to say to them, guys, you know, like, this is like tricky for me. It's really tough for me to balance. Like, but you know, I wasn't saying you offend me. I was just saying, you know, like it was a real culture shock for me. And if someone had come into that party and didn't know those guys and who they were, and just made assumptions about who they were, these people who, you know, aren't being offensive could have been pulled up and gone, oh, that's against code of conduct. See you later. Because they've got a voice clip with no context. That's the really worrying thing, is like having that could drop in and it'd be something where, you know, like you go, I heard that word. And it's like, well, yeah, but that's not the whole story. It's not the bigger picture. And like you said, though, Phil, the proximity chat, like it made me think, you were saying about lobbies. When I played Gears of War on the 360, when the OG Gears of War dropped, it was always that thing at the end of a match or in between rounds, it would drop back and everyone could hear everyone in the proximity chat or when you died, and the abuse that would go on in the dead proximity chat or in the end game screen was horrific. And I'm like, wow, these people are like, you know, this is crazy. So yeah, it's 100% right. I think recording proxy chat and public chat is where the bigger problem lies online, to be perfectly honest. But yeah, so we could go on with this forever. We could really go round and round.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, it's a big topic, and it's not just a topic that's you know, just been through here. You know, it's ongoing in all different industries and all different products, you know, so it's it is a widespread thing. And yeah, we could go on for hours and hours. We've got one more thing to talk about in the news, just going back to some PlayStation stuff. And this was quite recently that PlayStation showed off their new user interface, which is kind of, we've been getting very much dribs and drabs from PlayStation about things for the PS5. It's been really the polar opposite with the Series X and Series S, which has just been everywhere. So it's nice to kind of get a little bit more information. So I wanted to have a bit of a chat with you guys, get an idea what you thought of the user interface, you know, in comparison to the old one or in comparison to the Xbox one, or just anything you thought was decent, really. So I'm going to go to Alan first, you know, because I think you'd be able to, I know you're not a PlayStation owner, but I think you'd be able to give some good kind of blank impressions from it, you know, just seeing it from the video.
Yeah. I mean, as you're quite right, I'm not a PlayStation owner, but I've been around your house enough times to see it. And I think the universe, I think there's been a lot of sort of talk about the UIs between, you know, the Xbox and the PlayStation. I think most of the feedback that I've read about or heard has been that the PlayStation had a better or more user-friendly UI, although it has to be said that the Xbox has been constantly updating theirs, and sometimes it can be a bit confusing, quite frankly. You go in there and everything's changed again, and I can't find a thing. I think we had one a couple of weeks ago. And, you know, it sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. But overall, what I've heard about the PlayStation UI, I'm not that impressed, to be honest, because most of everything that they tout as being new and inventive has actually been a key feature of the Xbox UI ever since the Xbox One came out. You know, they're talking about being able to have the screen pop up and be able to jump into things instantaneously. In fact, they also have some features, you were mentioning when we were talking earlier on, Chris, that actually have been removed from the Xbox UI because they tried it and people didn't like it. So I suspect that may be the same experience that the PlayStation owners may have. But generally, overall, it's all good stuff. It's great. But there's not a lot of innovation there. Most of it is already available on the Xbox. So we're not exactly seeing, they haven't exactly reinvented the wheel. Mm. But if it works, don't fix it.
Yeah, that's the thing, and I think that's very much the ilk that Xbox have taken. They've just iterated and iterated continually, and it's just flowing this new user interface into the new series of consoles, so everyone's familiar and jumping in. You know, some people are like, I don't like that, I want something new and shiny, and I kind of get that, but there's also other people, you know, much like when we use our phones, there's not really much different when you go from phone to phone. You get a slightly better camera with a slightly faster processor with, you know, a slightly better screen, but usually the user interface is pretty much the same. You know, there's not huge exactly. differences between it. So I think we're kind of conditioned for it that way, really. You know, I'm going to go over to another non PS4 owner, go over to Chris now and just see, you know, what you thought, you know.
I looked at the video. I think what Sony have done is what I like is that Sony have looked at what people want. They've looked at what they've had feedback on, and they've gone, right, we need to make these changes and we need to add these things. And they've done those things quite well, I think. You know, it looks moderately intuitive. I think there was some stuff where I was like, there was some stuff that was just too much clutter, in my opinion. But it's just my opinion. I haven't used it. I don't know. I'm going all of this on a video showing what they wanted to show in a very curated manner. What I didn't like was that the shortcut menu, or the, what, well, I can't remember what they called it now, the one that you jump up in game, feels
the card
like,
system.
Yeah, the card system. I like some of the ideas in the card system. I think there's too much of it and it's a bit too cluttered personally. Like there's not a lot enough context in there for what I think. Maybe it's just, I don't know the context of those cards on the video. I don't know. I also thought like Alan was saying, the snap feature where you could snap a video to the other side. It's like, been there, done that. It isn't as great in practice as you'd like to think. You know, it's it has its moments, but generally it just gets in the way. It shrinks your game playing, you know, size. It doesn't translate well onto TV. It's a feature which, ironically, the snap on like a Windows PC is a phenomenally good feature. And I think snapping on a PC is one of the best functionality features I've ever used. Put it on my console, it was just awful. Like it worked, it did what it was supposed to do, but it just got in the way. And I think that's why I could see that happening. A couple of things I did like. I really liked the pop-out picture to watch somebody else playing. Whilst I don't think I'd get a lot of use out of it, my initial thought was, oh, that'd be wicked if you're trying to talk someone through a puzzle, or we're playing a co-op game, something like that. That could be really cool to see what they're seeing. So there's some good stuff there. I liked some of the idea that you could, when you send a screenshot to someone, one thing I really liked was, so if I'd finished, I don't know, we'll just say an Xbox game, Gears 5, and there's quite a big spoiler at the end of Gears 5, right? Which we won't go into because it's a big spoiler. But I could have easily sent that to somebody and completely ruined Gears 5 for them, right? Because it's a really powerful moment in the game, in the narrative of the story. Or like Mass Effect. Like, God, some of the stuff you could spoil in Mass Effect, right?
Yeah.
And completely ruin that game. And And the fact that the developers can flag anything like that, potential spoilers, and so someone who gets that message gets a thing saying, this may contain potential spoilers if you intend to play this game. I think that's a really cool feature. Like, it stops people trolling as hard as well, which is really cool. Because I've had stuff ruined for people like that. So I like that stuff. I really do. So there's some good stuff in there. I'm not the biggest fan of it. I really hated last generation's PlayStation UI, and I know I'm in a minority. I never liked it. So I'm happy to see them go somewhere new with it.
I think the last generation, the UI, was very much, it seemed, again, for me, I owned a PS3, I own a PS4. It didn't change dramatically. It was very much almost what Xbox have done and kind of iterated. But they didn't, maybe the changes were not just surface level. They were more deep down, you know, because I didn't use it as much. But I think they were more of that, whereas they've tried to do this big iterative change now. Big initial change now, and I've got to agree with you certain things. I think the card system seemed like a really good idea, just a little bit too cluttered. I like the idea of being able to watch other people's videos and stuff like that and be able to pop game help out from the side, and also the whole spoiler thing, really, really cool idea. Obviously, until people get their hands on it and see how it works, until it's in the masses, nobody really knows. But Phil, you're a PS4 owner, much like myself as well. So we're Xbox and PS4. So you've had a good run with a PS4 interface. Anything that really jumped out to you as good, or anything you thought was actually a step back?
I actually thought it was a nice refresh on the existing dashboard. It wasn't night and day difference. It clearly wasn't. It still felt like the same dashboard, but it just kind of had the pop-up cards instead. I think the cards are a nice touch. I like the fact that it would kind of list your newly taken screenshots. I mean, one of the big differences particularly between PlayStation and Xbox is the way they handle those screenshots. So when Xbox takes a screenshot, it's automatically uploaded to your stream. And as we're all aware of, our good friend Jules, who takes many, many screenshots, has had to empty his cloud storage at least 5 times because he loves a good screenshot. Whereas PlayStation, it's much more selective. Now, you can take 10 screenshots where you're playing through Horizon Zero Dawn, and then you can go through and you pick the one or two that you like, and then you can upload them, you can add comments to them, you can edit them. And I think that's a great version of that. But on the PS4, it was a bit clunky to find them. Like, you had to go to your video library, then you had to pick the game, then you had to go through your list of screenshots, and for some ungodly reason, the most recent one was at the bottom of the list rather than the top, so you'd have to scroll through all of them first. So it was a bit of a chore. It's basically, you had to go through all that process, or you had to be uploading and tagging and doing everything immediately as you took the screenshot, which, again, you know, it breaks the immersion in the game. So I think that's a nice update to it. I think it looks, you know, clean. I think it seemed nice and quick on there, which is a big thing. I did also notice they said the PlayStation Store was no longer an app that was running.
Yes, that's good.
It was actually built in a kind of like an operating system level, which I think is quite good as well, because I found the PlayStation Store a bit laggy.
Yeah,
Just like on the Xbox.
Yeah, I still find the Xbox Store a bit laggy as well when that loads as an app. The new Xbox Store is good, but it's still got its problems.
Yeah, you obviously haven't had the new update for the Xbox Store because it's rapid, really fast now.
I've got the new revamped version with the change of style and everything. So unless there's another update on that change of style, possibly.
So my experience of the store since the update has been like night and day to the old store.
Oh yeah, it's instant.
Oh, don't get me wrong. It's significantly faster than the old store, particularly when changing through the tabs. But getting in there is still laggy. It takes time to load it and for everything to load.
My
internet.
You have to put another 20p in your internet box, mate.
Yeah.
Turn that crank a couple more times.
I did think of one other thing from the Sony thing, which I thought was actually really awesome. And
yeah, go on.
I was like, good to see them do it. You know, there was one thing which, because I've got a friend who has issues with his hands because of an accident and disability. Having the voice to text option in PlayStation really easily accessible. Props to Sony for that. That's another way that brings gaming more accessible to people. I know we can do similar things with Xbox already, but it's just nice to see that in there, ready to go, accessible for gamers who don't have the easiest time, you know. So props to Sony for that. That was a really cool thing.
And the
fact you've got the mic in the DualSense 5.
I think that's a really cool feature
that you don't need that external mic. I mean, one of my favorite features with the first Xbox was actually the mic in the Kinect.
Yeah,
I used to love just being able to sit down, turn my Xbox on,
Yeah, but as we all know, as we all know, the problem with those is it's great for the person using it, not great for the people on the other end. It's just it's a really noisy and messy. But anyway, we're going to wrap up on that one there because, like I say, we sort of went over on a couple of points and we need to kind of tail it in a little bit as though it doesn't go on for 4.5 hours because, let's be honest, we can all talk quite a bit. So what we'll do is we're going to take a break from here and we will back shortly with a talking point.
And to tell it right, I gotta take you back to long before I squeeze this ass into red spandex.
Hello again, people of the internet, and welcome back. Thanks for listening to the news. We're now moving over to our talking point for the week. We got some positive feedback last week because we had a bit more time to have a bit of a conversation and do the stuff that we really want to do, which is just kind of talk about our experiences in gaming and films over the years. And we thought we'd kind of go back down that route a little bit. Now, this week, you know, there's been a leaked video of the new Xbox Series X being unboxed. It looks like potentially it's one that's been stolen from a distribution center. So it's definitely not an official video. But it kind of got me thinking that, you know, I've had a lot of new consoles over the years and I've had some great memories, you know, of Christmases when parents have got me that console that I've just always wanted, or, you know, when I've been older and saving money and just waiting for that day and queuing up outside to get it. I just really wanted to know, you guys, like, you must have some great memories as well from console launches. And I was going to go over to Chris first and just sort of see, you know, if you've got any sort of ones that kind of stand out, it'd be nice to share with a group.
Yeah, well, there's a couple of things. So consoles, this is the first generation I've been like hype level a million, I'll be honest. Like, I was really pumped for an Xbox One. I think my enthusiasm was tempered slightly by Microsoft's phenomenal mishandling of the launch last time round. Let's not kid ourselves. That was, shall we say, not their finest hour.
That's putting it lightly.
You know, I feel I'm being kind with that statement. So, you know, I've been excited for that. I remember like the first Xbox, like there was a little bit of me that was kind of like, I really want one of these. And I was trying to be sensible. And then they dropped into it was Dixon's actually back in the day. I was working in a phone shop and the guys at Dixon's over the way were part of the same company. And they were just like, they got them in. And I was just like talking to this guy. I was like, oh, have you got them? And he was like, yeah. And I was like, oh, and he's like, look, this is the deal I can do you. Do you want one? And I was like, well, go on then. And, you know, got a bit of Halo and that. So I was, you know, it was more a case of, I knew I wanted it, but I wasn't hyped for it. The one that, yeah, you're talking about memories and great memories. It wasn't a games console. It was a computer, which predominantly got used for playing games because, you know, that's what I did as a kid. I played computer games. And as a family, especially me and my brother, we were super, super excited to get a Commodore Amiga. And my dad had promised us he was going to get one for Christmas. And he'd sort of come to us like a few weeks beforehand and said, look, guys, I'm really sorry. We're not going to get the Amiga in time for Christmas. We tried really hard. It's not going to happen, you know. And we were just like, okay, Dad, not a problem. You know, we know you've tried, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We all had our Christmas presents. We all opened our Christmas presents. We were all happy as Larry, you know. We were just waiting for Mum to cook Christmas dinner, and it was all cool. And I'll never forget, I was sitting in my living room, and we had some neighbours at the time. We were really, really good friends with these American couple, where they were lovely people. And I just remember looking up as they walked past the window. You know, you see someone walk past the window, you look up. And in the hands of one of them was a monitor for the Amiga, and the other one had the box for the Amiga. And I just remember, I just grabbed my brother and went, oh my God, Andrew, the Amiga's here. Like, and he was like, what? And I was like, the Amiga's here. I've just seen it walk past the window. And they walked in and sure enough, there it was. And it was, I'll never forget, it was the A500 Plus Family Classics Pack. It had Lemmings with it, Bart versus a Space Mutant. So it was one of the games, which I can't remember if I'm completely honest. But I do remember like just being hype level a million at that moment. And like me and my brother running upstairs, taking everything out of the box, setting it all up. And we both been really looking forward to like games like, and I remember we started playing some games and we were seeing our uncle a week later, and our uncle had got a certain games, the games we really wanted. One of them was Dungeon Master and one of them was Chaos Strikes Back, the sequel to Dungeon Master. And I just remember like me and my brother just playing the absolute, just behind off that Amiga for like that whole Christmas holiday. And it was just the best feeling, you know. Mm-hmm. One other console that I remember, again, being my nonchalant self, kind of like not being particularly psyched for, but like being like, that looks really cool. I'm kind of interested in it. And then it dropped. And I remember having some money in my pocket for some reason. I can't remember why I had money. I'd been doing work and I was, you know, still relatively young. I had some money. I'd done a job or something. And I make it sound well dodgy, but you know, like I can't remember what I was doing at the time, but I was doing some kind of work. And I just remember thinking, I said to my brother, I said, I really want a Dreamcast. And this is about probably 2 days after it launched. And he was like, well, can we get one? And I was like, I don't know. And bear in mind, like Dreamcast launched, I was probably 16. I think my brother was like 17, had recently passed his driving test and had his car. And so we started looking for one, and we found one, and it was in Lakeside. Now, you guys probably know the journey from Bury St. Edmunds to Lakeside, you know. Mm. And this was like, we properly did this, like seat of the pants. So the, whatever store it was, Game Station or Game, whoever it was that had one, I rang up, you said, you've got one? They're like, yeah, yeah, okay. I was like, you've got these games? Yeah, 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 okay, right. What time do you shut? And they're like, 8 o'clock. And we were like, right. And me and looked at the clock and it was like 5:30. Right? And I was like, we're coming to get it. And they were like, we'll be there before you shut. And like, we just jumped in a car, drove down to Lakeside, like picked up this this console, took it home. I mean, I played it all night. It was, and that was a console which I think the you know, was one of the ones that really set me on console gaming. Like that console has lived with me, and I miss that console. I thought that console was phenomenal. Some of the games on that were like, the only fighting game I've ever really loved was on that console, and you know, among others, it was such a phenomenal pick, and that's a really great memory. So they're my big ones, and like the hype level is like fast approaching now for this new console. I am like champ. I can't wait to get my hands on a Series X. I'm really pumped for it. I'm every day checking for news and stuff. So yeah, they're my probably my ones. But the Amiga was the big one. The Amiga just it to this day, it's one of my best memories of as childhood, of like, you know, presence in that, and you know, my brother's reaction was the best, where he just didn't register when I said the Amiga. So he's like, what? It's like, you've been there. The look on his face is like, it's complete. What'd you say? And it's like, and I was just like screaming at him, you know. So that's great.
The what's in a who now?
Yeah.
Huh? Oh, that's quite quality. Yeah, I think, you know, that I'm well psyched for the Series X coming up. I think it has been exacerbated by the fact that we're doing this podcast, and we're so invested in all the news, and we're talking so much about it. I think we're all hyping each other up as well. But yeah, I'm so psyched for it. And I think, you know, I've been quite a loyal Xbox fan, you know, right the way through. You know, I had the original Xbox, the 360, the Xbox One, and we've been through the rough time of the Xbox One, and coming up to almost like a bit of a redemption story. It's a bit of a Rocky story. Do you know what I mean? It's like I feel like the champ's coming back, which is really, really nice.
I think that's something, yeah, just really quickly, don't want to take too long out of everyone's time, but like I said to you, that launch of the Xbox One, the original, it was just diabolical. I mean, even as a fan, I was a huge Xbox 360 gamer, and the Xbox One announcement happened, and I will never forget, I sat there and watching it, and even I, like as a hardcore fan, sat there and like literally got so frustrated, I got on Twitter and just tweeted, will somebody, I said, I get it, TV on the Xbox, but will somebody, for the love of God, play a game on the games console? I was so frustrated. And then like, this generation, I mean, we had that statement from Phil Spencer, I forget which E3 it was, I think it was the last one, he said, you know, we heard you, we understand, a games console should be built and optimized for one thing, and that's playing games. And it's like, yeah. And like, and then the Series X showed up, and it's like, and you meant it, that thing is built and optimized to do one thing, play games.
Yeah, it's awesome, mate. Awesome. Yeah, I mean, I was going to share one of my memories next, if that's all right, boys. I know I normally go last with these things, but I was trying to think, because I've got so many different memories of different, you know, consoles I had. You know, I remember having my first thing was a Commodore 64 back in the day. I had Master Systems, Mega Drives, and all different consoles all the way up. But one that really, really sticks out to me is, I remember one day I was walking home from school, and I used to pop into this little shop called the Games Cavern. And it was tucked down a little side street, and it was a tiny little shop. I mean, it was no bigger than the office I'm sitting in now. And I'd go in there and I'd have a look at all the games, and there'd be a guy sitting behind the desk, and I'd always sort of have a bit of a chat with him and ask him about the new games, because this was pre-internet. You didn't have free access to all the information like you do now. And I remember walking in and looking and seeing this grey box sitting on the side with a TV going, and then the guy who worked there was playing it. I was like, what is this? And it was the Sony PlayStation. And this is the first time that I'd seen those. I think you guys spoke about it last week when I wasn't about arcade quality graphics.
Yeah.
And that was the first time you saw it, because he was playing Toshinden, the fighting game, which was kind of, it came out before the Tekken came out. And I can remember just standing there looking at it, my jaw dropped open. I could not believe what I was looking at. The graphics were stunning. I mean, you look at them now, they were pretty ropey, but you know, back then it was incredible. And he let me have a go on it, and I played it for probably about half an hour and thought, oh heck, I better get home because mum's going to kill me, I'll be late for tea. So yeah, got home, and then all I did was just bang on at my mum and dad, I need one, please, you know, what can I do, what jobs can I do around my house, how can I earn any pocket money, can I have, like, I won't have anything for my birthday if I can get it now. And I must have gone on about it so much, my dad finally at a weekend drove us over to Comet in Cambridge. Now, I don't know why we went all the way to Cambridge, because it was like half an hour away from where we lived. But I think Dad had shopped around for the best deal. He was always one of those people, even if you get a fiver off, he'd drive 100 miles to get it. But I remember being in Comet. I remember being in Comet in Cambridge, and Dad, he got it on like a buy now, pay later for us or whatever. And I was going to pay him back with my like paper round money and, you know, money that I had saved up and stuff like that. And I remember getting home and I was allowed to put it onto the big TV downstairs. Now, this TV downstairs was massive. It was a Nikam digital stereo 29 inch Mitsubishi TV. It was a beast. It was not a widescreen. It was 4:3 aspect ratio. Just remember I was allowed to have it down there for nearly a whole week. I just remember sitting playing Ridge Racer and Toshinden, and my friends came around as well, and they were like, wow, and it was just the best. I was just couldn't believe the quality of the graphics. And it's just, it just always gives me just a great feeling. I can picture myself now sat on my knees in front of this 29 inch TV just playing this PlayStation, just being blown away by it. That's kind of my story, really. What about you, Phil? What stories have you got?
So, a bit like kind of Ratley, I think I'm very, very excited about the Series X launch. And I think the main reason for that is this is the first year where my PC is worse than the console that's launching. Like, previous generations have always updated my PC and got better graphics cards and stuff. But this year, it's smashed my PC out of the park. So, very excited for that. But much like you guys, my best kind of gaming memories of consoles in particular are from when I was a lot younger. I think probably I've got two that really stick out to me. The first one would be the Master System 2 with Alex the Kid pre-installed.
Oh, yeah.
It was a, yeah. And Sonic and Tails was the other game. I absolutely love that game. And it was my birthday. My parents bought it for me. It was one of those where, like, no, I tell you, it was Christmas. They bought it for me at Christmas. And on Christmas Day, I got all my presents. I was like, oh, this is great. And I got, you know, like a radio control car and a few other bits like that. I was, you know, pretty happy with that and, you know, carried on. And then we went out and visited the relatives on Boxing Day, had a meal, came back. And my dad was like, might want to check under the tree. I'm like, all right. Had a look under there. And there was another box wrapped under there that wasn't there yesterday. And I was like, oh, okay, this is exciting. And I unboxed it, and I wasn't expecting this, and I hadn't asked for anything, and there it was, the Master System 2. And I was like, yes! It's like, oh, can I play it on the big TV? Yeah, go on then. You better check the rest of the tree, though. And I was like, what? And I had a quick look at the tree, and there was two more games wrapped up in the tree as well. And I was like, yes! Oh, it's such a good memory, because I just wasn't expecting it. And yeah, like you, I was allowed to play it on the big TV. The 28 inch Sony 4:3 CRT.
Nice.
A whole,
was it,
like,
was it Trinitron?
It was, yeah. I mean, that thing must have weighed like 30 kilos.
Kids these days will never know, like, LAN parties and TVs, like when you used to take all the TVs to someone's house, right? Oh, anyway, I digress. Sorry, Phil.
Yeah, you can never be employed by an electrical retailer now and have to pick up something as heavy as a 32 inch widescreen CRT TV. No warehouseman will ever know that pain.
Yeah, it's like it's as bad as a washing machine, isn't it?
Pretty much. It was pretty much there, and the weight was all in the front, so it was even worse. It's not like it was even evenly distributed. It's just horrible. And I think my second happiest memory of console gaming is pretty much exactly the same thing. My parents got me again a couple of years later with the original PlayStation. So again, I'd seen it in Toys R Us. I was like, oh, that looks sick. And it had, again, the Tokiden demo, and I was like, oh, look, Dad, that looks so good. I want one of those. He's like, oh, maybe. And this was a good, like, 3 or 4 months before that Christmas. And then, again, I'd almost kind of forgotten about it and written it off. I was like, oh, I've got my PC. I'm not going to get one of those. And then under the tree, on Boxing Day again, wrapped up. You better check under the tree again, son. There it was. So, unwrapped it. PlayStation 1. Yes! Copy of Porsche Challenge in there as well. I absolutely rinsed that Porsche Challenge game. Played it so much. Like, I learned all the shortcuts to beat the computer. Complete the whole game. Unlocked the black test drive Porsche that was twice as fast as ours. That was awesome.
Thanks for that, Phil. That's awesome, mate. Yeah, it's nice to talk about these things. It kind of brings them warm, fuzzy feelings back, doesn't it?
Yeah, man.
So, last but definitely not least, we'll go back to Mr. Longfangs. Alan, well, have you got anything for us?
Well, it's a bit different for me because, you know, I've got a good decade on the rest of you. So there weren't really consoles. In fact, not really consoles when I was a kid. So I didn't get bought any consoles by my parents. So I don't have any stories like that. And also, you know, I mean, yeah, I'm excited about the Xbox Series X coming out. Of course I am. But I kind of measure that against the excitement that I feel for Cyberpunk coming out 3 or 4 weeks after that.
Mm.
And that there's just no comparison. You know, it's a piece of hardware. I hope it works really well. And I hope all of the games that I put on it are going to be super awesome. And yeah, there is some excitement and there has been excitement for consoles. But, you know, I'm far more excited about the games than the actual hardware itself. If I try and think,
sounds
back,
like bitter resentment that Cyberpunk's not coming out on launch day.
Damn right, we've already had this conversation, haven't we? Because it was like, what game do you want to play first? Well, I want to play Cyberpunk. It's just not out yet. But
we did
you
have
know,
a chuckle about you waiting 9 days to unbox your series.
No chance.
Play Cyberpunk.
Yeah, I think it'll probably be dirt. In this instance, after you've bought it, Phil. But, you know, I mean, there have been consoles through the years that I have been excited for. I mean, I was working as the manager of choices in Bury St. Edmunds when the Xbox came out. You know, it was really, really exciting. I was waiting for the release and like working there. I had no problem getting a console. Same with the Dreamcast. But, you know, it's kind of trying to say how, you know, was I super excited? No, I was great to have one. I think two memories that I want to share is the first one is my old brother-in-law. His brother worked for Team 17, and once I got taken up to Norwich, where one of their offices were, I didn't even have a computer or a console at this stage. I'd just come out of college, I had no money, I was trying to find a job and everything else, and I went up to their studio, and we're talking to like the owner and looking at some of the fantastic stuff. I think they were doing Rapid Racer at the time, and they were showing me some of the water effects. It was a really cool experience. But then we went into this guy's office and he had a PlayStation, just like your story, Craig, and he was playing Project Gotham. And I was like, oh, my God, I didn't realize gaming consoles had come that far. You know, obviously, as you said, we look back now, it's a bit ropey. But back then it was like the most amazing thing I'd ever seen. And I spent the next 3 months saving every spare penny that I could to go and buy one. So I was super excited about that. But I think my main story would be the first console, in a sense, that I had an experience with was when I was about 11 or 12. And I know we did actually have a console back then in them days. That was before mobile phones and laptops. And quite frankly, I think we had a TV that was possibly had colour, but I think some of it was painted on. And one day my dad came home and he had a ZX Spectrum. My mother absolutely hated it. She refused to let him play it on the TV. Totally didn't understand technology, and he had to resort to getting up at 6 o'clock in the morning so that he could sit there and play it before he went to work every day. I'm sure he won't mind telling that story. Yeah, I know. That's where I got my gaming habit from, my pa. But and I took that console so that when it wasn't being used, I could take it, you know, into the spare room. We did have a spare crappy TV, and I could play there. And you know, I mean, obviously very basic games, Manic Miner, Jetpack, Asteroids, all those classic retro games. Yeah, absolutely. Such fond memories about that. And also taught myself how to program in BASIC using the ZX Spectrum and, you know, got a computer science O level, which is absolutely useless today, but I enjoyed doing it at the time. But yeah, so that's really my console memories.
Oh, that's great, mate. No, thanks for that. And I guess, well, let's kind of move on from there. And I suppose for the few people that listen to us, you know, as I said before, you can follow us on Twitter at Unnamed Games Pod, or you can leave comments if you want as well in the podcast services. You know, get in touch with us, you know, send us a DM, you know, if there's you've got any kind of stories that you want to share about memories and things like that. You know, it'd be great to be able to read some stuff out and get some feedback to anyone who's listening.
We'd love to hear your stories. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
totally. Yeah, definitely.
The
stuff
funnier,
yeah,
the better.
Yeah.
Hey, if it's not funny or it's emotional, that works as well.
Anything, it's just nice.
We're
going
to have to play the
so
music like da 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 da.
No, Alan will start crying if you do that.
I'm already crying.
Before the waterworks start and the tears start flowing, we're gonna cut now for a break. So we will see you back shortly for a game, and it's not just a normal game. We've had plenty of PvP, but now we're gonna do some co-op PvE. So we'll see you in a minute. Hello and welcome back. So give you a little teaser just before the break. We're done with the PvP this week and we're doing some PvE co-op. So I thought there was potentially some bloodshed between Chris and Alan, with poor old Phil standing in the middle trying to hold them apart, maybe taking a few stray bullets after the fights from before. So what we're going to do this week, let me ask you boys, I'm going to ask you first, Chris. Have you heard of 20 Questions before?
I've heard of it. I don't really... Oh, is this... Oh, actually, hold on. This is the... You've got like a, like you'll give me a word or something and I have to describe it or something like that, right?
No, I'll go through what it is. I'll go through what it is. It's all right. Phil, have you heard of 20 Questions before?
It's good. Yeah, I like 20 Questions.
Nice.
I'm not sure we're up to the challenge, though.
Is it like mineral, vegetable and whatever?
Sort of. Yeah, sort of.
That's what I'm thinking,
right?
Yeah.
So what this is totally ripped off from another podcast that I listen to, but it just inspired me when I was listening to it. I thought this is the perfect thing to try and bring synergy and harmony back to the group.
Misjudged this.
Yeah, I may have done, yeah. So this is video game 20 questions, okay? So basically, so you're clear on it, Chris, what it is there is a game that I have in my head, and you can ask me 19 questions to find out what that game is. It'll be any questions, right? They have to be that I can give a yes or no answer to.
Yeah.
Okay. and then you need to be at a point before you get to that 20th question, or you can ask on the 20th question, you have to tell me what that game is or before, but you can work as a team.
Okay.
Yeah. So, you know, you could ask, like Alan was saying, animal, mineral, yada, 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 whatever.
So it's exactly what I thought it was. Yeah. I just explained it badly.
Yeah, okay, yeah. So, right, so I've got the game. I have written it down on the top of my piece of paper.
You say, have we got 20 questions as a team?
As a team.
Right, okay. So before we
start, you can discuss
questions. Okay.
Yeah, so you can discuss together between you what you want to ask, and then once you have made a decision what you want to ask, then talk to me. Okay, right, now go for it.
Okay, I'm thinking, what colour shirt is the protagonist wearing?
It's got to be a closed question.
Yeah, yes or no question,
say.
Alan. You could ask, is the protagonist
wearing a blue
shirt? Yeah, you could ask that.
It's already gone wrong.
Okay,
we've just started.
So first of all, we need to find out the genre, right? So we need to be specific. Is it a shooter or is it a... But we need to make it so that we don't waste any sort of question options.
Mm.
So we need to know what type of game it is, then that can narrow it down, don't you think?
Well, that'll be...
Yeah, we could also...
single player, multiplayer, like, things like that.
Yeah, and try and narrow down like which generation of consoles it's on.
That's a good start, actually.
Is it a platform exclusive? Things like that, you know?
Yeah.
All right. Who's going to ask the first question?
I'll go. Craig, is this on the current generation of consoles? So Xbox One, PlayStation 4, Nintendo Wii, not Wii.
Switch.
Yes. I say that funny.
Hesitation.
Oh, he hesitated there.
Does that... Does that mean it's going to be on either previous consoles or next-gen consoles as well? So if it's previous and next-gen, like, for example, that makes one clear candidate. I guess we can find out if it's a previous generation and the current generation.
I think that's a good question, because I got the impression from Craig. Yes, if it's backwards compatible, yes, it's available on the next generation of consoles.
Oh, that doesn't
narrow
it
down.
Was it released in this generation?
Yeah.
So here we'll ask that.
I worded it badly.
So here we go. Craig, was the game released in this generation of consoles?
No.
See?
Ooh, so it's a backwards compatible.
He's trying to do us dirty there.
What a cheeky monkey.
Nothing dirty. Nothing dirty.
So it must be on the 360 or
Well, it was from the necessarily. Xbox. No, it could be OG Xbox as well, because hold on, didn't he say it was on Switch as well? It's currently available on Switch.
He said this
generation, didn't he? But he didn't.
He said not this current generation, didn't he?
No, he said it wasn't released this generation. But when he was asked the first question, which is it on this generation? He said, yeah, right. So we know it's an older game, which is currently playable on current gen. Do you know my brain's gone straight away with this? And I'm just like, oh, could it be? Could it be that cheeky? Like, my brain's gone to Doom. Because Doom was an old school
game. Or The Witcher. Because that's
Witcher. But was Witcher 3 available on 360? It wasn't, was it?
No, that's true. I don't think it was.
So Doom's gone right to the top of my list for some reason, because you've got Doom on like old school PC. It's been released on basically every console since like the SNES, I think. And
hey, Chris. Go on, ask.
Craig,
is it Doom? Go on.
Craig, is it Doom?
You can't ask.
If you ask this early on and you get it wrong, the game's over.
Do we forfeit our questions? Right. Okay. Sorry. Didn't understand that part. So we'll hold that.
You need to narrow it down to like your class. Like, is it a shooter?
We'll ask that then.
Monsters in hell on earth.
We'll ask that. Is it a shooter, Craig?
No.
Ooh, there you go. I'm doing you wrong horribly.
Yep.
Okay.
So it's not, but that's not a shooter. So that's interesting.
How about this question, guys? Can we find out whether it's available on all consoles or whether it's available?
Yeah.
So
that could be just a generation, didn't we?
If it's Halo, then it's going to be just on the Xbox. Well,
it's obviously not Halo.
But what I'm saying is that you can narrow it down a bit more by fun.
Okay, so well, we want to narrow down, is it an Xbox exclusive? Is it a PlayStation exclusive, for example?
Yeah.
So someone shoot that question over.
Go on, Alan.
So the question is this game an exclusive to a particular console?
No.
Okay.
Mm.
Right. Okay. So we've
my
got
mind
that
is sort of, I was going to say my mind kind of wanders to GTA, but he said it's not a shooter.
But GTA's not a shooter. It's got shooter elements, but it's not a shooter.
I suppose it's more of an RPG, that's obviously, you know,
that was my
GTA
other thought,
or GTA 5 particular.
That's a good question, though.
That
guys.
Was my other question, was GTA 5 was the one where I said if it was.
I was going to ask the question, is it part of a series of games or is it a standalone game?
Shoot that across, man. That's a good one.
That's to you, Craig.
What was the question?
Is it a standalone game or is it part of an IP or a series?
The question
of games?
Would be, is it part of a series of games?
Yeah.
Is it part of a series of games? Yes.
That narrows it down a bit.
When,
so we're talking.
When I
Gears,
said my first,
Halo.
My first one, I said, "Is it going to be available on like this last gen, this gen, and next gen?" I said, "There's a clear cut winner, which would be GTA." Was my thinking because GTA 5 was on 360, is on Xbox One, and will be on next generation. Because let's face it, Rockstar will milk that till they can milk it no more. It's become the new Skyrim.
Back-compat, everything that's on the current Xbox is going to be on the next one, so it doesn't really help us.
But will it have a next-gen upgrade would probably be a more legit question, because that's going to get a proper next-gen upgrade.
Possibly. Yeah, so it's not platform-exclusive, so we've got to think across all the platforms.
I think GTA is a really good shout in that respect, because it's not a platform-exclusive.
I said about Switch.
Because GTA
Switch
used to be a
platform-exclusive,
didn't it? Hold on. We said current generation, and you listed the consoles. You didn't specify whether it's available on all the consoles. That might be a question.
And we also asked the question, is it exclusive? He said no, but he didn't dictate that it actually state that it was actually available on all consoles. So it could just be available on the box and the PlayStation.
Do you want me to give you a recap on what the answers have been so far on the questions?
Yeah, go on.
Yeah, go for it.
So you asked if it was exclusive. I said no. You asked if it was on current gen. I said yes. You asked if it was a release this gen. I said no. And you asked, is it a part of a series? And I said, yes.
See, I think that GTA is ticking boxes, so we need to need to eliminate it, really.
Okay, so how can we eliminate it without asking a direct question against GTA 5? Do we say, is it...
Well, why don't we ask if it's like a role-playing game?
Is it an open-world game is a good question. That'll take GTA out of it straight away and a lot of other games.
You could ask, does it have multiple protagonists, for example? Multiple playable protagonists?
But that's a bit specific to GTA
specific.
Again. No, but I'm saying we're trying to narrow it down. So if we ask the question, is it an open-world game, then that either eliminates or completely puts us back
ask
into...
Ask the question, Alan.
Do it.
Who's the question?
Do it.
Craig, is it an open-world game?
It is not.
There you go. GTA's out then.
Well, we're screwed here.
So, narrowed down. So it's not an open world. So I'm now thinking things like maybe Ori, because I think the original was on... Was that an Xbox One original? Was that a 360?
So Ori isn't a platform exclusive because it's on Switch, but is it on PlayStation? It's not on PlayStation, so...
And would you also consider it a series of games? There have been two,
well, it is
believe,
now.
Haven't there?
Well, it will be. It will be. Really... No, it is now, yeah, it is now, because the second one's launched. So there is definitely it. But it was an Xbox One launch, so it wasn't Xbox 360. Yeah. So it definitely can't be Ori.
So how are we gonna find it down even more? We know it's not open world. We know it wasn't released on this generation of consoles. Yeah. We know. What else do we know? I'm not sure what we know.
Do you want another recap?
It's not a shooter.
It's not a shooter.
It's part of a series of games. It's not an open world game. It's not an exclusive title, and it's available on multiple generations of machines.
Did we ask whether it's a platformer game?
We did ask if it's exclusive to a platform, didn't we? I thought we asked if it was a platform.
No, I was talking more about the type of game. Style of game.
I think we should ask if it was like a role-playing game where you have like, you know, leveling up and unlocking powers and stuff, maybe.
Go for it, Phil.
Yeah. Is it a role-playing game where you would level up and unlock powers and abilities?
Is it an RPG game? No.
Okay. Mm. All right.
The plot thickens.
Now, I will say to you guys, okay, that is question 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's question number 6. All right, you're on so far. And this isn't obscure, this game. You will have all heard of it and probably all played it. Not that helps.
Okay. What about, is it a story-based game? Like, is it a story-based game would be quite important? Like, because obviously you've got multiplayer shooter. Well, it's not a multiplayer shooter, we know that, but it could be a multiplayer game, like something like, I don't know, Lemmings or something. But if it's a story-based game, we know it's like a story-based game. It might narrow it down.
I'm sorry, off topic. Lemmings wasn't that a quality game. wasted so many hours.
So I guess so asking, is it how would you do this? Because you want to eliminate, is it a single-player only game? Would mean that we know it's a single-player only game as opposed to a single-player and multiplayer.
That's a good question,
Yeah, so is it a single-player only game, Craig?
Yes.
Ah. Okay.
So now, is it a story-based game? I mean, I'm now heading towards maybe things like Setsuna's Sacrifice, Hellblade, because I don't think there's any leveling particularly in that.
But it's an Xbox One title again, man, and it's Xbox One.
It's not a series or IP because the second one hasn't been released yet.
Yeah, and I was going to say, and it is a... And the fact
it's
that it is
It's not a series.
It wasn't a 360 game.
It's on PlayStation as well.
It wasn't a 360 game, so...
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay. So we need to narrow it down more. So what questions can we ask? We've got 15 questions, right? So we've used 7.
Ooh,
so we're halfway there.
Ooh, hold on.
Can we be a bit more specific at this point?
Hold on. What about BioShock?
It's a good one. That's a good call, actually.
Well, it's a shooter. We asked if it's a shooter and it's not. I always forget that it's a shooter and it's just more like story driven. Like I'm like story.
Does it have something like maybe an iconic character in it? So if it's like something like, I don't know, it's the new Mario game or something like that.
Tomb Raider.
Could be.
You level up again in Tomb Raider, don't you? You spend skill points to unlock abilities.
Yeah, I guess.
Consider that a role-playing game.
But it wasn't originally.
Like maybe
A quick way to solve that would be to ask the question, is the protagonist male or female?
Good question.
Well, you'd have to ask, is the protagonist male? And it's a yes or a no, isn't it?
Yeah. So,
yes,
yeah,
is the protagonist male? Yeah.
Unless they were a gender-neutral blob, of course.
that's entirely possible. Was it a Detroit human? They're robots. But,
Let's ask that. Let's ask that. I think that's a good
Craig,
shout.
Is the protagonist male?
Yes.
So it's not Tomb Raider?
Yeah, what about if we went down the line of, like, you know... Can you customize your character? Like, you know, do they change clothes and stuff like that? Or is it like a fixed look to the game?
Is that going to help you identify the game?
Well, it cuts out any games that have customization in there.
That's like... what about, is it a license? Like, you know, is it like a Star Wars game or something like that? Maybe ask that kind of question.
That could be quite good, yeah.
Yeah, mind
good
you,
having,
go for
is it based,
having
on,
said that,
is it based on a license?
Yeah, hold on. Having said that, do we know of many Star Wars games that aren't either role-playing or shooters?
Well, that just narrows that Star Wars, doesn't it? There's still other IPs.
Yeah, what I'm saying is it a licensed IP could bring you like Batman, it could bring you
You know, I need to push you for a question here, boys.
Ask the question.
Is it a licensed IP?
No.
Right, okay.
I'm lost. I've
Do
got
you
no
drive
idea.
Cars in this game?
Good question. Go for it.
No. That's 10 questions.
Okay, so it's not a racing game.
Do you... how about this one? Are you on... Is it based on the planet Earth? How about that one?
Yeah, do you want to ask that one?
No, I'm asking the guys. Yeah, okay, I'm asking you, Craig.
Yes.
Here's one for you. So it's not what a about space guys? Game. What about if we asked, we're assuming, is the protagonist human? We don't know for definite. The protagonist might be human.
Yeah, if you want to ask that, go for it.
Is the protagonist a human?
Yes.
Mm.
Do you want to recap on your questions? You're on 12 at the moment.
Yes, please.
So the answer so far, you asked, is it exclusive? I said no. Is it on current gen? I said yes. Is it released this gen? I said no. Is it part of a series? I said yes. Is it open world? No. Is it an RPG? No. Is it single player? Yes. Is the protagonist male? Yes. Is it a licensed IP? No. Is it set on Earth? Yes. And is the protagonist human? Yes.
What about Prototype?
So that's an open world, isn't it?
It's open world, yeah.
Same as like Infamous as well. Actually, that was.
I kind of zoned out a second while Craig was telling us yet again what the questions were. But did we say it wasn't an RPG?
It's not an RPG, and it's not a shooter. We covered those two, wasn't it? It's an RPG.
It's not a racer either, because I asked if they drive cars.
Yeah, drive cars. So we can know that.
I'm going to give you a little hand. Just because it's not a shooter doesn't mean it hasn't got shooting in it.
Yeah, well, by shooter I meant was it like a Doom or a Halo?
Yeah, no, I know.
Like
just clarifying.
Yeah.
That's a good question. Actually, is it a looter shooter? Would you consider shooter, Division to be a shooter?
It's still only it'd be any the looter shooter is only tank three as well.
Actually,
could be Destiny.
Actually,
it could
I guess. Be an RPG.
I would still consider that a shooter.
Yeah. Okay. So I would say predominantly the mechanic areas you shoot stuff, don't you? Like Destiny as well is the same thing.
Well, in my experience,
so not,
most of the time,
a shooter, and it's not a racing game. So, what other genres does that leave?
It's not a
role
playing
game.
Platformers.
Yeah,
like something like Prince of Persia, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, or
That's a good.
Is it ReCore or something? Oh no, that was.
What about what's that Tomb Raider? What's that Tomb Raider like on PlayStation?
Well, Tomb Raider is a female protagonist. It's a male protagonist.
Tomb Raider
Uncharted.
Alike. Uncharted.
Well, there's Uncharted and there's Prince of Persia. Both of those.
That's a PlayStation exclusive. So that
it's
not an
exclusive. Prince of Persia would be one I'd be looking at because that's multiple platforms. It wasn't released this generation. There is a generational version of it.
Is it Ark?
Is it Ark?
Right.
It's an open world.
Push you for a question, boys. Push you for a question, please.
Is it set in current day?
Yes, around current day. Yes, it's modern. Yes.
Okay.
Current day for the time it was released, we'll say that.
Are we talking maybe Watch Dogs or... No, that's open world. That's no good.
That's an RPG.
And an RPG. So, I'm struggling, boys. I'm not sure.
No, I'm really struggling. We're going to kick ourselves when we hear it. We're like, oh, you son of a...
Yeah.
yeah, probably.
Does the protagonist have a blue shirt?
You've got... Well, you're on 13 questions, so we need an answer.
2 questions.
20 questions. We've got six questions left. No, five questions six. Left. Six? I don't know. Six, then we have to give an answer, right?
It's a good job this wasn't a maths quiz.
Oh, mate, don't talk to me about numbers. I'm awful with numbers.
I know, 176 dinosaurs.
Shut up.
This is supposed to stop all that.
Never! Till my deathbed.
You're struggling, aren't you, boys?
I'm struggling. I don't know what other questions to ask to identify the specific game, to be honest. I mean, guys, anything?
So we'll go back again. So is it exclusive? No. Is it on current gen? Yes. Is it released this gen? No. So that would suggest it's probably backwards compatible of some description. Is it part of a series? Yes. So there's going to be more than one of the games. Is it open world? No. So we know it's going to be some kind of linear game. Is it an RPG? So there's no real leveling system or anything in it. Is it single player? Yes. Is the protagonist male? We know it's not, you know, Tomb Raider or any of the sort of big female characters. Is it a licensed IP? No, so it's not a big Star Wars or Marvel or anything like that. Is it set on Earth? Yes. Is the person human? Yes. Is it current day? Yes.
It's not.
So one, you, no, maybe one. If you try and narrow down more into what type of game it is, might help you.
What about Pac-Man, Dishonored?
Pac-Man's not human.
What about Dishonored? Can we ask a question that will kind of either confirm or deny that? It's not open world. It's not open world. It's not a shooter.
It's not modern
and
day.
It has a
though.
Male protagonist. Well,
yeah, it's not modern day. That's true.
The situation that it's based in.
Okay, it's not modern day. Yeah.
Would it help if we narrowed down whether it was a first or third person game?
I was thinking that. That was a good question. Yeah.
Is it first or third person?
No, you can't ask that. That's not an either or. You have to ask.
Is it third person? Is that what you're asking?
Is it third?
Is it a third person perspective? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so it's one where you look over the back shoulder of the character.
So try and have a think about what type of games you play in third person.
Well, platformers, I would have thought.
But wait, is it a sports game?
Are you asking that as a question?
Yeah, like FIFA or, you know, basketball or something. Is it a sports game?
No.
Okay. Sorry, boys.
That's all right. No, that's a good question. It's a good question. But it was a linear story.
15 questions you're on. So, you've got four questions left.
So by that, what we've asked so far, does that mean it is definitely a platform style game?
Well, it's getting close to that there or thereabouts, yeah. Isn't it? Yeah, so I would say platform is almost
like
candidate.
What platform style games do we know on the previous generation that had male protagonists?
So what about things like, oh no, it's a human. Did we say it was a human? Yeah,
it was
a
human. So it can't be like Crash Bandicoot,
and it can't be like Sonic or something like that.
Yeah,
fair enough.
So do we?
What about things like Alan Wake? That was single player,
platform
story driven,
platform exclusive.
Oh, was it only on Xbox?
Yeah, only on Xbox.
Afraid so.
Okay,
I'm stuck.
Dead Rising?
I can't think of a game.
Dead Rising?
Isn't that open world, though?
Yeah, I suppose it could be, yeah.
Yeah, and
especially
you have some
one,
leveling
yeah.
and stuff in
especially
that
especially the new
world,
one, yeah.
Yeah.
It's some kind of... Some kind of platform game, to be fair, but I'm trying to think of platform games now. I'm really sort of drawing a straw. I kind of like Prince of Persia.
Okay, I'm going to give you a tip. It wouldn't be classed as a platformer, but that doesn't say there isn't platformy elements in it.
There's platforming and shooting in it somewhere on the lines.
Platform-ish elements in it.
Platform-ish.
Are we talking Half-Life here? No, that's a shooter.
Yeah, it wouldn't be thought of as a platformer.
Portal.
That's not part of an IP, though.
Portal 2.
That's true. That could be it, you know. But that's a female protagonist.
Oh, it's a first person.
And it's first person.
What about, boys, what about Hitman?
That's also good.
Ooh.
I mean, I know that, I suppose the newer ones are open world, but the older ones were quite linear.
I like that. I like that as a guess.
Is the
protagonist platforming elements, so shooting elements. Yeah, I like that. It's a stealth game predominantly, isn't it, Hitman?
Yeah, exactly. Ask the question about the baldness. That'll clarify it.
So here we go, Craig. Is the protagonist bald?
No.
Oh! It's not Hitman.
Dagnabbit.
You
that
are
was a really good shout, man.
Getting
really
close,
good shout.
Boys. You
that
are
was a really
close.
Good shout. Really,
Ooh,
really
he
good
says
shout.
He says we're getting close. So Hitman, what game's similar to Hitman?
Oh,
kind
Splinter
of type
Cell.
Of game? Oh, that is a good call.
Oh, so how can we narrow that down? Something like, do you creep around
did
in the
Ubisoft
shadows,
publish
or?
It?
Does Michael Ironside voice the protagonist?
There you go. Does Michael Ironside voice? That's another one. So, yeah, we'll do... Does Ubisoft publish it? Because that will help with the general anyway. So, does Ubisoft publish the game, Craig?
Yes.
Yeah, it's got to be Splinter. Does
Michael Ironside voice the main character?
He does.
There you go. So, yeah,
Wait, do we have to narrow down which game it is, though? Because even the original Splinter Cell is back compatible on the Xbox One.
It was the last generation. So what was the last one that came out? Splinter
so we're talking
Cell?
Things like...
Oh, he didn't say. He didn't say. He just said it wasn't this generation, didn't he? That's all he said. We didn't say last generation.
Yeah, so we're talking about Double Agent, Conviction, Blacklist.
Or the first Splinter
Cell. The crap ones.
Yeah, because I don't think Chaos Theory or Pandora Tomorrow ever made it over to the consoles, did they?
No, they were there.
They did.
Yeah, they all did.
Theory. Yeah, that was on the X360.
The first one was a console release. They've all been console releases.
All of the Splinter Cell games are backwards compatible.
Yeah. Does it matter we need the exact one, Craig?
I think it does, yeah.
Okay, so how are we going to figure out which one it is?
So we could eliminate one by saying, was it on the original Xbox? I think that's only the first Splinter Cell, isn't it?
Do it. No, I think
Pandora Tomorrow.
I thought Pandora Tomorrow was on the original one as well.
Okay, so that potentially narrows it down to two, doesn't it? That narrows it down to either two or three, whether it's like Chaos Theory.
How many questions have we got left, Craig? How many Craig questions?
You have got two questions left.
Oh, and then we have to guess, right? Then we have
No, sorry. You've got one question and a guess.
One question and a guess. So I think we should ask, was it on the original Xbox? Because that takes out three of them.
I think that's a good call, but yeah, I'm going to go with Chaos Theory myself, personally.
Right, let's just ask that question. Go on, Phil, hit it.
Was it originally published on the first Xbox?
Yes.
Okay.
It's Chaos Theory.
Really? I'm inclined to say it's the original.
I think it's OG. Just go for the original. I think it's OG. Yeah, I think it's OG.
I think he's a traditional man and he's going to go OG.
I'm not sure because let's face it, when you look back at playing Splinter Cell, what was the best co-op experience you ever had? Which was the game that you played?
But it was a single player game. Single player game.
It was, and I played the campaign.
Yes,
but that doesn't
Chaos
mean...
Theory had co-op.
Yes.
Yeah, it's single player only. It's like single player only, so we can be fair enough.
It can't be Chaos Theory. I think we have to go with the original.
I think it's OG. So. I really do think it's OG. I think it's the, you know, it's 2-1
it,
here,
Phil.
So,
was it the original Splinter Cell?
Well, for your final question, before you had to answer, your final question, yes, it was the original Splinter Cell.
Oh! That was
well done,
tough.
Boys.
That was a lucky punt with the hitman that steered us in the right direction.
Yeah, that hitman got it, and then
not a lot of steerage from our good host.
Hey, it was your first go. I thought it was only fair to give you a little bit of a little bit of a boost. I think you did really well there, boys, and it's a nice bit of team bonding there for you. So hopefully you won't murder each other with blunt instruments. But it's a thanks to IGN GameScoop podcast that I heard that on for giving me the inspiration for doing that little thing. Did you enjoy it though? Was it fun?
Making us think. Loved it.
I mean, the grey matter was struggling in the middle there. There was an intense workout of the grey matter there.
Fantastic.
Well, I think most of it.
I think we've really, really have run over on time on that one, but I think it was worth it just to play that little game together.
It was good fun.
Hope everybody who is listening at home enjoyed it as well, because I certainly enjoyed listening to the boys struggle. It was fun.
Let us know on Twitter.
Yes, do. Remember, it's at Unnamed Games Pod, and remember, please subscribe to our channels just so you can get the regular episodes and you don't miss anything. We'd really appreciate it, and it does sort of help us feel like we're not talking to nobody. So on that note, it's a bye from me, and it's a bye from Chris.
Bye.
It's a bye from Phil.
Bye bye.
And it's a bye from Alan.
Arrivederci.
See ya.
Hasta la vista.